Yeah, and it's on Fowler with the pass that ended up causing the breakaway, and it's on the back check as well, allowing Austin Watson to get the rebound in. But right off the face-off, and something we've kind of been waiting for, because this is actually the first time Kessler and Johansson have both been on the ice since the playoffs, Johansson, I guess he really jumps Kessler, immediately regrets that because Kessler bumps him a couple times. Johansson turtles, and then Kessler mocks him for the turtle, which ended up being a great gift that we ended up putting out. But yeah, I mean, again, we were talking about how we don't see Kessler fight that often, but now he's fought two guys who don't fight it really at all, in Taves and Johansson, and he's pretty much got the better of both of them.
Yeah, no, I mean, good on Kessler there, man. I thought that was great. I watched that, and I was laughing, especially when he started, you know, pretending he was turtling after the fight. Some people on Twitter were commenting about how Kessler shouldn't be swinging when Johansson was quote unquote down. What you got to understand is this is a fight and a matchup. These guys hate each other. Johansson runs his mouth off the ice, on the ice to Kessler, I'm sure. And Kessler's no angel. He, I'm sure, has said a number of inappropriate and expletive things over to Johansson his way on the ice. But Johansson has been very vocal in how much he hates him. And, you know, he kind of gives Kessler a shot off the faceoff, and then Kessler takes care of business. And Johansson's a bigger guy. So to see him turtle like that is kind of funny. And I got to hand it to Kessler there. That was probably the best highlight before we get into the third period.
Yeah, and that one was kind of interesting because it kind of looked like Kessler didn't have anything to really want to do with that fight. And I don't want to get too in-depth and breaking down this fight for about 10 minutes. But it just kind of seemed like he didn't really want to have anything to do with it. He wasn't really ready for it. It's really Johansson who jumps him. And we were talking about earlier how there was kind of a little bit of stuff happening in the first period with Manson and Getzlaf bumping into Johansson. And this seemed like it was kind of boiling for a while up until this point. But I digress. We move into the third period. The Ducks are down 3-0. And it's looking bleak at this point. I feel like most people didn't expect the Ducks to come back. You know, they've been playing well lately, but the way Nashville's playing and the type of team they are, there's not many teams who are going to come back down 3-0 against them in the third period and win. But the Ducks gave it a go. I mean, they started a bit better at the beginning of the third. They outshot them 5-0 in the first 4 minutes. And then they get the first goal as well. So Arvidsson hits the post. So the Ducks get a little bit of a break. And Getzlaf takes it the other way, feeds Perry, who sends what I think is probably one of his better assists this season, a perfect slot pass to who else but Ricard Rakell for just a beautiful goal. And he continues to score.
Ricky Racks, baby, lighting it up, staying on fire. But, I mean, that pass by Getzlaf, he looks like he's going to shoot, but, I mean, everyone should know better. He's not going to. That's not his game. I mean, he's not the guy that's going to be trying to wire the puck up. He's always looking for that open man. And, boy, did he find the right guy there. I mean, Rakell was just a beautiful, you know, a beautiful shot. But, I mean, it was all Getzlaf there.
Oh, for sure. I mean, it was all Getzlaf and Perry on that play. And it's nice to see that line continuing to play well. Obviously, Rakell extending his goal streak, getting within one of number 30 on the season. And from there on, there was a lot of pressure by Anaheim. They had an extended period of time against Nashville's fourth line in the offensive zone. And then Ellis goes off for hooking. But, of course, the play doesn't really continue from there. There wasn't much going on the power play. Rene stops Cogliano on a point-blank shot, and we're thinking from there, this is, you know, pretty much it. The Ducks are going to have to make something special happen now if they're going to make a comeback. And it started looking upwards. I mean, Getzlaf wins a puck battle, throws another terrific pass to who else but Ricard Rakell in front, and he gets number 30. He gets number 30 in this game, back-to-back 30-goal seasons for Ricard Rakell.
One of the best contracts in the league, right? I mean, talk about a steal there for Bob Murray. Let me correct myself. I meant Perry made the slap pass. I kept saying Getzlaf, and I was like, wait a minute. No, I had it mixed up. I blew that. But talking about the second play there, Rakell, I mean, what can you say about this guy that just – the tear he's on right now is incredible. And then back-to-back 30-goal seasons. He's almost at 60 points. He's on fire, man. And it's just really, really great to see that the Ducks look like they finally have that top line solidified. And, hey – they didn't have to go out and get a left winger. like me and everyone else and their mothers have all barked at Bob Murray to go out and do.
Yeah. I mean, he's just been on fire, and it was looking like the Ducks were going to make a comeback, do the impossible, take it in overtime, grab a point from Nashville. But, you know, they got caught cheating a bit. They had the pressure. Fowler pinches a little bit too high, and Forsberg and Arvidsson end up getting a 2-on-1.
Yeah,
I know. Nobody wants to hear this, but Forsberg makes a great pass. Arvidsson has an open net, and that's game pretty much after that. And disappointing, because that was actually a really nice attempt at a comeback by the Ducks. For once, they didn't get caved in the third period. They actually did the caving in against Nashville, and it's unfortunate because it was a good effort to try and get back in this game.
No, it was, and it really sucks that it was all for naught there. I was on my way home, and I was just sitting there, and they scored, and it was 3-1, and they scored, and it was 3-2, and I was like, okay, I'm almost home. If they can get this to overtime, there's a chance that I'll be able to catch OT on TV, and then, you know, you and I can go live right away. Because I was tracking the game the whole time on my phone when I was at the rink, and then I listened to it on the way back. I was just praying for the different outcome, but obviously we all know that that is not what happened. And it was strange. It was a flip-flop game for the Ducks. Usually they recently have been sitting back in the third period and not taking chances and then, you know, holding on for dear life to a lead. So, I mean, that just goes on for me to ask you, Eddy, is this something that – is it a coaching issue with Anaheim? Or is it what we talked about before, like a league-wide issue? When you have a lead, you sit back. You have a lead and you sit back and then let the other team pour it on. I don't know. I think – it's hard to say, but I kind of feel like it's all over the place there. But it's disappointing to see the Ducks can just turn it on one game and not have it the other games prior.
Yeah, I think it's kind of a mix of both, and I know it's a little bit of a cop-out answer, but I think the Ducks do have an issue with it, but it is a league-wide issue, like you said. There's a lot of teams who get a lead going into the third period, especially when you're up 3-0. I mean, this was a carbon copy of the game against Washington going into the third period, just flipping the script. I mean, the Preds were up 3-0. They were playing a pretty solid game, but not really an exciting game. It was more of a boring 3-0 win, just like the Ducks had over the Caps. And then you go into the third period, that's where it gets a little bit different, but the Ducks are the ones putting on the pressure. And yeah, I think a lot of teams sit back in the third period. It's nice to see that the Ducks kind of, like you said, flipped the script and were able to put on the pressure in the third when they were down. But it just, when you go in and you're down 3-0, especially against this team who had won 9 in a row, you can't make it that difficult for yourself. I mean, against any team, not just Nashville, you can't go into the third period down 3-0 and hope that you're going to make a miraculous comeback. We've seen the Ducks do it before, and they came close. But when you get to having to get that last goal, you know, you open up a lot of opportunities, and that's where Forsberg and Arvidsson made them pay. And it's unfortunate because they end up out shooting Nashville in this game as well, 33-28, just because they outshot them 18-7 in the third. So I like the effort for the final 20, but the first 40 was not enough for them.
No, they can't wait around that long. I think even Rakell said in the post game that he said we sat back on our heels a bit. And I mean, that's, I guess you could say that, but I mean, you got to give Nashville the credit as much as I don't want to. They're a great team, and the Ducks just found a way, I guess, to push through in that third. And when I say the Ducks, I mean, it really was just that top line. You know, Rakell, Getzlaff, and Perry, the ones that are converting here. That second scoring line, I guess you could call it, with Richie, Henrique, and Kasha really needs to start wake up in these kinds of situations and games. The Ducks are going to need it for the playoffs here when they get in, because I feel like they're in that mode where they're going to get in now. But they really need some secondary scoring, and that might have helped out in this game.
Yeah, for sure. And they really got dominated by Hartman, Turris, and Smith. And that was, I guess, a makeshift line for the Predators, because this was Turris' first game back after the healthy scratch. And yeah, they didn't really get anything going. This is about the third or fourth game straight that the offense kind of dried up for that line. Obviously, like we said, Getzlaff, Perry, and Rakell have picked up the slack, which is what we expect from them. But it's disappointing, because we kind of thought that this line was trending upwards. They got put together, good things were happening, and then all of a sudden, they kind of just fell off the face of the earth. They just disappeared without any trends of slowing down. They were hot, and then they're not. And it doesn't mean they can't get back there again, but I think if the Ducks are going to have continued success, it looks like Rakell, Perry, and Getzlaff are here to stay, and they're going to continue playing well. but they're going to need another line to step up, because we were talking about how Kessler, Silfverberg, and Cogliano were playing well, and they didn't do that great in this game either. It really was just the first line that got things going, and that's not going to be enough, especially when you're playing really deep teams like Nashville.
No, it's true. They got to find a way to wake those guys up. And even that Kessler, Silfverberg, and Cogliano line, yeah, they've played a lot better recently. But we just got to get it. We got to get that stuff moving along here for the Ducks to have some success. But let's go ahead and put a bow on this game. I don't want to talk about a loss and dig too much deeper unless you have some more things you want to add in there. It's a painful one. Badly as I wanted to beat Ryan Johansson. You know, it's weird. I didn't hate that guy until he became a Predator.
Yeah. No problem. Until the playoff series, even. But when he came a Predator, I was like, whatever. It's fine. And then the Ducks, you see two playoff series against him and a heartbreaking loss against Nashville in the Western Conference Final, and you learn to hate players on that team. I'm sure eventually if the Ducks end up playing Nashville again, I'll learn to hate PK Subban. But, yeah, I mean, I didn't hate Nashville. I actually liked Nashville as a team and the way they were built, and I'm still impressed of the way they're built, but now you kind of just learn to hate them because you've played them in some pretty tough series and lost. And I think the same goes for Nashville fans with the Ducks. But there's a lot of reasons to hate the Ducks when you've got Perry and Kessler in your team.
Oh, absolutely.
So I get it going that way. But, yeah, I agree with you. I didn't mind Ryan Johansson until the whole thing went down with him and Kessler.
And at the same time, though, I always got to point it out. It's gamesmanship. I mean, you're going to try to talk trash and get under someone else's skin. That's just the way of sports and the way that you market things and market your team and bring a spotlight, you know, to where you are at to promote. So I don't mind any of it at all. I mean, and when I say I hate, it's just as like I don't want them to win when they're playing against the Ducks. But I've already praised this team, and I don't want to do it anymore. I mean, I would love to have Johansson on the Ducks, if that says anything. That would really help out there down the middle with our aging centers, right? I don't hate him in that sense, but, God, I don't want him to win. And I love when he gets beat up by Ryan Kessler. So, Ducks are not able to take down the Preds. They lose this one 4-2. Nashville keeps up their 10-game winning streak, or gets their 10-game winning streak as they move on. The Ducks have to look ahead to tomorrow night in Dallas, which is going to be another tough go. But let's get to some interesting post-game stuff that we have set up around here. You were pointing out to me a tweet by Cole Anderson earlier about Gibson for the Vezina. We talked a little bit about this last game.
Yeah, and he had tweeted back me saying, you know, the Vezina discussion is pretty much Rene Vasilevsky, but Gibson has some numbers that puts him in that company. And he was saying, you know, maybe Gibson more for MVP other than the Vezina, and you know, I find it hard to disagree with that as well, because he said MVP. I'm assuming he meant heart. It's a tough go when you've got guys like Taylor Hall, Connor McDavid, Nathan MacKinnon to fight with. I think that's just saying he would have more of a chance of winning that than winning the Vezina, which I don't know if I 100% agree with that. I think that at least the numbers that he was showing on there as well, that maybe it makes the case more for the Vezina, because they were pretty close to what Rene has. They were above what Vasilevsky's, because Vasilevsky's actually trending a little bit downwards. Not to say he's playing bad, but he's not at the same level he was in midseason when the Hockey Raiders had him as the favorite for the Vezina. But, I think it just kind of reinforced our discussion. And, you know, we went pretty far in depth on our second show about why Gibson should be in the discussion for Vezina. So if you haven't heard that, head back to that one and check it out. It's not that old. It's only a couple games old. I'm used to saying checking a couple shows ago, and it's like 2 weeks old because of Ducks and Pucks. But, yeah, so check back on that one if you want to hear the whole discussion about Gibson for the Vezina. We talked about that for about 15, 20 minutes, so there's a lot of content in there. But I think it just adds to a discussion. So if you haven't seen it, check out Cole Anderson on Twitter. He tweeted out, I believe it was a day or two ago, the stats that put Gibson up in discussion with Rene. So it's pretty interesting to kind of reinforce the opinion that we had.
Yeah, that was that around the same time where he retweeted the money puck?
Yeah, around the same time. And okay. There's a lot of things that kind of put him up in that discussion, but you don't hear about it.
No, and you and I talked about the wins when it comes to Gibson and how he doesn't have those. But I mean, His games played are right up there. He's two behind Quick. He's right there with Pecorine. He's ahead of Mike Smith. He's six behind Vasilevsky and five behind Bobrovsky as of yesterday. Yeah. So or yeah, yesterday or earlier this morning, rather. So he's got those numbers, but it's just, I mean, the case for the heart. I'm going to ask you a question. How